Hello and welcome to another episode of Teppou Republic. On the last episode, we saw Takamichi going up against the Sado army that was marching on Hida province, catching it up and engaging it in battle. We set up a nice formation on a hill and outgunned the enemy, plus made good use of our own cavalry to stop the enemy's cavalry from hitting our lines, in the end defeating them quite soundly. Then Angakoji Yoshiyuji was on the offensive in Suruga province, attacking one of the Sumpu armies after we found out that the Sumpu don't have many forces left and we decided to put more pressure on them. Then we saw a Satsuma Imperial Vanguard army land itself near Hanuma and Takayuki's position. We'll have to see what that does. Then the Sunpu counterattacks Yoshiyuji's forces. He managed to back up the small group that was under attack to force a fair battle. It was a nice dingy day where both sides' artillery were not being put to very good use because of the forested conditions, but we ended up defeating them by sheer skill and the zeal of our troops overcoming the enemy. Then Tanenao attacked the province of Kai, one of the Sunpu's strongholds, leaving them without any troops and with only one castle left, and Nagakoji Yoshiyuji should be able to finish them off. Let's continue. The local people have been less cooperative than expected. We're already short on food, but we should have brought a proper baggage train.
No, you are wrong. The baggage train forces us to move slowly. Without it, we shall be so swift that the Emperor will see our faces almost as soon as he has heard of our approach. Besides, the capital surely cannot have fallen in line with the Sulais. There we shall have all the supplies we need. This current shortage serves only to inspire our men to reach our destination even sooner.
You assume it will even be possible to get that far on our current supply? The truth is, if we don't raid the villages, then we'll—
No! Raiding the villages is exactly what the Sioux would want us to do. We are here as champions of the people and the Emperor.
Then what if we'd run out? Are we to attack Osaka Castle? I have heard the Sioux have a garrison there large enough to hold it for years.
And since the Sioux are using railways, there could be a Sioux army at the capital by the time we reach it. My men can't fight without food.
These paranoid speculations are doing us no good. We attack the capital, we do not stop before we get there, and we do not let fear of battle take a single breath from us. Understood?
Yes, my lord.
Welcome back. You can see that Tanenao has indeed just captured Kai, but he has some reinforcements who he left behind in the last episode because the opportunity to take Kai was so good I couldn't wait for them to arrive. Those reinforcements will now start making their way to join up with Tanenao, and eventually we'll have a formidable force that can attack east towards more shogunate lands. You can also see we've captured some copper reserves, good news. Anagakoji Yoshiyuji is still besieging Suruga, so for now I'm going to let that situation continue. Takamichi, who defeated the Sado forces here in Echu, is now going to move up towards Echigo. I know the Nagoka are up there, but I'm going to use the shinobi I have standing around to find out exactly what the situation is. You can see the Yonago are besieging the port in this area. It seems the Imperials are still going at it with the Shogunals, despite also having to face me. The Nagoka have almost nothing here, it's just a few Yonezawa forces who are standing around the castle for unknown reasons, but overall looks pretty weak, so Takamichi should be able to push into that area soon. Now I also realised that I can pull up more forces to join Yoshiyuji with the siege on Suruga. I can also pull up this shinobi who currently is hanging around to Toyama but isn't going to be needed there. Once I capture Suruga, I can slot him into the town to expand my line of sight or have him march with Yoshiyuji, so I'm going to move him up. Now, way over in the west side of our domain, the Yonago are currently besieging Tamba, and I decided it's about time we stop them from doing this. I noticed that their army is very melee heavy, whilst ours is very missile heavy, which in general gives us an advantage. Their melee heavy army will only have an advantage if the terrain and the weather are both in their favour. So, assuming that's probably not going to be the case, I felt pretty safe just attempting to beat off this army with a siege sally. You can see the balance bar is about even, but I do think I have an advantage. The enemy has an initial artillery advantage because my artillery will have to come in as reinforcements. But once I'm all set up, I'm pretty confident I can destroy this Yonago force as long as it doesn't get too close. Let's see what I can do about it. Now, we've seen this battlefield before, fighting the Yonago actually, in a pretty similar situation, and I'm going to use the same strategy I did then. I deployed mostly on a ridge on a slight hill on my right flank, with an extended line going off onto the plains on the south side of the map. Pretty much just a big long line infantry line, with a few blocks of melee infantry behind, ready to move out if needs be. The reinforcements coming in are two regiments of cavalry, very useful, and loads of artillery. That artillery is going to be slow moving, and I'm ordering it to go and sit on the ridge behind my troops where it would be able to fire over them, but actually it's not even going to get there before the enemy arrive. They're already pretty close, they're running right at us. My mortars are set up already, so I do have a little bit of artillery to put some pressure on them, but mainly they're going to advance unmolested. They've got lots of thick lines of melee troops, just a few missile troops in the vanguard, and a couple of missile troops at the back as well. Not a particularly good use of their missile troops, really. They do have this artillery already set up, which is currently firing at the extreme left of my army. You can see these formations are a little bit disrupted. It's these domain guards, which you might remember last time when we fought the Yonago here, the enemy artillery focused on the domain guards as well. So those domain guards really must have done something in past lives to be attacked so much by artillery. So the enemy's advance is going to be slightly hampered by my mortars, but for the most part, they're actually going to be fine. The enemy, of course, does have reinforcements coming in as well. You can see them here, a few units coming over the hill on the north side of the map. But since the enemy are just charging right in, those reinforcements will not link up with their main force before the attack begins. Now you can see the enemy on both of their flanks are sending out cavalry. On my right flank, I have my own cavalry, who I can set up in a position to counter their cavalry, stopping them from getting behind me. On the other side, I don't really have a good way to stop their cavalry. However, because they've advanced in front of the main force, they're now receiving the focus of my gunners, who are firing at them pretty rapidly. You can see all of the enemy's artillery is landing way short of my line. They're very inaccurate, those enemy 6-inch guns. The enemy cavalry get really close, they almost get a nice charge on my line, and a point-blank volley from two lines completely obliterates their unit. A couple of men get caught up by my spearmen, the survivors sensibly run away. Meanwhile, on my right flank, I've used one unit of cavalry to lock the enemy's cav down. The other unit is set on some waypoint orders to take this small bit of high ground and then turn and charge into the melee in order to finish off the enemy cavalry. My one unit was actually winning because of its superior experience, but now we're going to completely seal the deal by charging down the hill, smashing into the enemy's cavalry ranks, and that causes the enemy's cavalry unit to rout. So on both sides, the enemy's cavalry advance has been thwarted. Like those fleeting images of a dream fighting for your attention as you awake, these Imperial thralls bellow and shout like a train of fools. They will give their lives out of sheer envy for the glory, the pride, the national renown of us, the heroes who history shall say changed the world for the better. Think nothing of those lowly worms cawing for recognition, bashing their outdated texts and dying for their outdated traditions. Take faith in the future that your rifles will bring. Take aim at the men who refuse to cast off their darkness, and take the lives of those who oppose the revolution! So now the main part of the fight has started in the center. The enemy with all of their melee units are simply charging us, that's pretty much all they can do. The rolling hills gives them some cover, meaning a lot of them get really close to our line as you can see here. But now coming up the final hill towards the position of our men, these troops are being gunned down and their morale is suffering. They're falling back as they get close. A few men who do get really close are countered by my own Yadikachi, who push them right back. The enemy forces are put into disarray essentially as I come around onto their flank with this echelon to put even more fire on them, which causes some of the full strength units to start falling back. This force doesn't have a general, so a lot of their lesser men are falling back even without putting up much of a fight. These reservists, for example, aren't going to fight for long, they take a few casualties and get out of there. Some of the more professional units, like these attendants and the rifle attendants hanging around here, will fight on, but of course the loss of all their allies means they're pretty much doomed. Meanwhile, my cavalry has been flirting with the enemy's reinforcements. Here you can see I'm charging a unit of Bokachi, who managed to get a nice volley on me, but it barely did any casualties whatsoever. And now I'm going to completely reverse that situation by dealing extreme casualties to these Bokachi. You can see on the tooltip their numbers have dropped extremely quickly. Their unit is wiped out in just a few seconds. The problem is that the enemy reinforcements are now advancing up this hill towards my cavalry, but I still have an avenue of escape, so I'm going to get out of there and leave the enemy reinforcements to just be chasing me, not taking part in the main fight. That main fight is now pretty much over. Look at this hillside, completely covered in enemy bodies. The enemy's main force has been simply wiped out, taking casualties as it came in, routing without fighting, taking even more casualties as it went out. Only a few of their bravest troops remain. You can see these guys are in a position that means they can't be hit by many of my troops, but a couple of them are managing to just about snipe off some of the enemy's front soldiers, then they fall back and take a blast of mortar fire just to finish them off. So the main body of the enemy's force is now going off the field. They still have these artillery pieces who have decided to relocate. They're moving up the hill for reasons unknown. Handy for me because they were actually dealing a few casualties to my flank by firing at me, but unfortunately for them, my cavalry are going to come down said hill to counter their advance, and now these light guns are in a lot of trouble. Actually, the cavalry aren't particularly good against light guns. I think light guns have very high melee stats, so you can see they actually don't lose anyone to these cavalry charges, and they even manage to fight on for a good number of seconds before any of my men manage to start killing them. But even once they lose a couple of troops, their army losses will have caused such a morale shock that losing a few of their own regiment will cause the entire regiment to break. Those enemy reinforcements are still coming in, though they are not going to break just because the rest of their force has gone, which is a very brave move. These Imperial Loyalists are even getting some shots on my cavalry, so I had to get out of there. I realized that since all of these reinforcement units are just following my cavalry, I can simply move my cavalry back towards my own line, which you can see I'm doing here, so that the enemy's reinforcements will just come over here and have to face my main force, which is still just standing, haven't given them any orders at all. My artillery has finally arrived late to the battle. I might even get a couple of shots off against the enemy's reinforcements. So they pretty much routed after a minute or so once they realized nothing was going well. The replay actually corrupted and caused my computer to crash before it finished the battle. One unit was still left over, but I'm sure you'll believe me that we managed to defeat that final unit. As you can see on the battle results here, absolutely insane performance, under 100 casualties, thousands of enemies lost, and we even captured some of the enemy's light guns. A very good result for the forces of Tamba. The Yonago will not be happy about this crushing defeat. Some more good news is that one of the officers amongst those forces is now eligible to be promoted to a general. I decided I would go ahead with this. It would be very good to have another general here on the Western battlefront. So let's see who it is. It's a guy by the name of Kurimitsu. There's nothing particularly special about this guy. He doesn't come with any particular traits or any bonuses. So he's a pure bog standard general, extra loyal, ready to lead our forces. So hopefully he'll do good leading men out of Tamba, which is now a much more viable option now that there's a general nearby. His first mission is going to be to wipe out Yonago's survivors, which of course he can do with ease. No particular worry about these survivors, but it's good to get experience for this young general, trying to get him up to rank 2 by winning a couple of battles. He loses 0 troops in the process. These men of Tamba are going to be pretty used to fighting battles where they lose little to no men. Hopefully I won't be able to break that record for them going forwards. Now I have many options that I can take with him. I can support Takayuki, I can support Takahisa going into Tango, I could even march west and have this guy go on his own campaign, but in the end I decided to just hang around in Tamba and defend it until I knew what I was definitely planning to do about the whole Western strategy situation. Now you might remember, I'm currently gambling on whether the Satsuma I'm going to go against Harima or Setsu. Both are okay, I'm ready to defend both, so we'll see what they do as we go through to the next turn. They get rid of their ships, they wander off back west, perhaps to get another force to bring over to invade, and then they march eastwards. Looks like they're going for Setsu, although they didn't march straight towards the castle itself, which was interesting. Now Harima also comes under attack from other forces, so it seems that even if the Satsuma aren't going to attack Harima, other people are. Both the Matsue and then the Hiroshima, more importantly, leading quite a large force into the province once all these boats were got out of the way, rushing straight in and then taking cover in some forest. So it looks like Takayuki's got a bit of clearing up to do, whatever happens. Then the Odawara attack towards Suruga, even though I haven't finished taking it yet, so it seems they plan to go to war with us as well, the first time we've really fought with Odawara forces. So I was wondering, looking at the Satsuma army, was it going for my tea fields, or was it even going for the capital? It's facing in a direction and has moved in such a way that it could be doing either of those. It could still also be going for Setsu. I noticed I could move forces to defend the tea fields to prevent them from raiding them, but I don't want to force a battle in the open if I don't have to. The ideal situation right now is for the enemy to attack Setsu, because Setsu has Osaka Castle, the best castle in the game, which is extremely easy to defend. You might remember the problems I had taking it. So I'd like to try and use that defensive advantage, if I can, by luring the enemy to attack the castle wall. So I'm going to gamble that that's going to be possible and take a defensive stance for now.
Everyone else is very well and wishes you to know that they pray for your success every day. It seems that as the weeks have gone by, you have moved further and further away from us, in both senses. I know the pressures of this war must be hard to bear, and you are going through something I would never wish upon you, but please remember that you are only a man. Once all this is over, you must be able to return to how you were before all this. Return to us and be able to live happily, putting the darkness of this war behind you. Of course, I know nothing of that struggle, but I'll do all I can to help.
The hidden Hiroshima army was revealed during the end turn sequence, so now we can just attack it with Takayuki's force. It runs away, it's quite damaged, it's actually mostly melee units that are not really in quite a fit state to fight, so they get out of there. I can't really pursue them though because of the Matsue forces who could come down and attempt to take Harima or at least damage the infrastructure. So I decided I would just hang around the castle and continue the defensive in this area and see what all these enemy armies actually do. Up in Wakasa, Takahisa has finally reached the battlefront. It's finally time for him to get involved in a campaign moving west into Tango. I'm going to link him up with some extra forces from the castle at Wakasa, who've been there for absolutely ages now, defending this area against a possible Yonago attack, which actually never came in the end. So these guys are finally going to get some action, joining up with Takahisa's group as reinforcements, just going to follow him in. I'm also going to link up as reinforcements the new army of our new general Tsuchiya Kunimitsu, who is going to abandon Tamba for the time being and come and help Takahisa take Tango province. I am gambling slightly that nothing will happen in Tamba and there'll be no enemy invasions to worry about, but I think, given what I know about the enemy's strength in the area, that's an okay gamble. Back over in Suruga, all of our movement points are recharged. It's time to fully attack Suruga Castle by bringing in reinforcements and, of course, Anagakoji Yoshiyuji's artillery, meaning that now, when I try and engage the castle in a siege assault, the balance bar is super in my favor, so I'm going to take my victory via auto-resolve. This, of course, is the final stronghold of the Sunpu clan, so that's the end for them. Just over 200 losses, over 1,000 enemies killed, and wooden cannons captured, whoop-de-doo. So yes, that's the end of the Sunpu. A long-term enemy has finally been defeated, hopefully the first of many long-term enemies to topple in the near future. This province also has the potential to build a railway station, so I can connect it back to Owari and get it easily reinforceable, just like I could with Harima province. The Odawara are moving into the province already, as we saw earlier, so I might have to defend it very soon, so I'm just going to cluster around the castle ready for that. But nearby in Kai, Tananao's forces are going to move out without waiting for reinforcements to start moving towards Musashi province, the seat of the Shogun and one of the key victory provinces on the map. I decided that if I could catch it unawares and simply capture it and hold it for a while, this would be a key gain in terms of territory, morale, and it would mean the Odawara clan are potentially going to be outflanked if Tanenao was to then move back west and attack provinces like Sagami. Meanwhile, up in North Shinano, you can see Kodama's going on the offensive against this small Nagoka group. I don't know what they're doing, perhaps they had the same motivation as the Daimyo that came down earlier. They've brought a set of units which I've never seen before, Prussian advisors, a bunch of Westerners it seems. I don't know what they thought they were doing or what their plan could have possibly been, but whatever it was, it's been thwarted by the sheer military strength of Kodama and his men. So North Shinano remains safe. And of course the situation for the Nagoka is now getting really bad. We can see to the north that Echigo, their final province, isn't looking particularly strong. They only have a few forces left with the defeat of their daimyo and those advisors. And Takamichi Takamichi is going to take advantage of this. The plan for him is to move right on their capital and attempt to take it. I'm using the shinobi to make sure there's no surprises coming up from behind their capital that might stop me from doing that. It looks pretty clear, so it's probably going to be safe for me to take the two turns I'm going to need to march over to Echigo from the border at Echu. I am also going to have to defeat those Yonezawa forces who are hanging around, but of course that should be no challenge. You can see there are also some hostile navies. These are actually Imperial navies that are currently attacking the Nagoka, which partially explains why they're so weak. So they might bombard me, but overall, not too worried about that. We should be fine. Echigo is almost as good as in our hands. Now moving into the next turn, that Satsuma landing force moves and goes past Setsu. It doesn't look like it's going to attack the castle. Interesting. The Suano clan move a small group past Takahisa and his forces into the forest. The Matsue bypass Harima and appear to go towards Setsu, also very interesting. And that Hiroshima army that ran away from us earlier moves back and attacks the telegraph office north of Harima, preventing me from building the railway station that I was trying to do. Very inconvenient indeed. Perhaps I can take revenge. The Odawara clan are moving around and they move more forces into Suruga. So it looks like they do plan to attack the castle, although of course they can't possibly take it, so in many ways moving closer is just making it easier for me to counterattack them. Now we have news that an army somewhere has been sabotaged, and that could potentially be very bad, but actually it turns out it's just these guys in Mino. For some reason the enemy decided to sabotage them, but luckily that does absolutely nothing to my plan. I don't care about those guys, so fine, the enemy are just wasting their money on that sabotage. Very good news. North Shinano is almost safe, but Kodama is still going to hang around there and defend just in case something happens. The Edo still might invade from the east, and I'm about to secure the north, of course, by trying to take Echigo, which I'm going to sort out now. First, I need to get rid of those Yonezawa forces that I mentioned earlier. They will not stand and fight because obviously they have a massive disadvantage, so that just pushes them out of the picture, leaving my route to the castle completely open. I'll begin sieging it with Takemichi's army. We already have a good advantage. You can see the enemy force crucially has no artillery, especially no mortars, so I can use my artillery advantage to reduce their numbers before I actually go into the assault. Also, the reinforcement group has some upgraded elite skirmishers, some sharpshooters who will be able to take our enemy units on the wall really easily, further reducing their strength before we attack. So I'm going to use these siege skirmish tactics to try and minimize the amount of enemy resistance, and then I'm going to go into a proper castle assault. I'm going to do that on the battlefield and try and make sure that Takemichi's force remains as intact as possible, giving us the option to move on and attack further enemy provinces right away. The Shogun must be rapidly preparing his headstone now. A hard march would put us at the gates of the Shogunal Palace of Edo in 10 days. Doubtless he will have fled by the time we arrive, destroying the morale of those small-minded folk loyal enough to defend the center of their world. But just think, once the Westerners learn that the capital of their trading partner has fallen to so-called rebels, the speed with which they shall withdraw their support for the Shogun will be a thing of legend. I cannot wait to stand in the Shogunal court and declare the rule of him and his Bakumatsu council over. I've deployed on the highest ground I can find near the castle. I still don't have an ideal line of sight, but it's going to be good enough to start bombarding the defenders inside, giving them volleys from my parrot guns. Already one volley has taken out a whole bunch of their garrison infantry defending the walls. So slowly but surely, I'm going to be able to whittle down these forces, destroying the fort walls and killing men inside. You can see I've got a few attack groups. You can see them on the minimap as well. Positioned around the castle, they're just going to stand there and watch for now. I've also got those reinforcements coming in from the north part of the map, and those are the guys who have the sharpshooters among them. So I need those sharpshooters to come up and help me out. Unfortunately, the enemy's forces are all on the south side of the castle mainly, so they're going to have to walk all the way around the map in order to get involved in this battle. Unfortunate, but I've got ages to wait. I've got a 40-minute battle to play out, so I might as well spend at least half an hour just destroying the enemy, using up all my ammunition. Over time, you do get diminishing returns as the enemy units that are highly damaged become increasingly more difficult to damage further, but I'm just going to wait out and see how much damage I can do. One thing the enemy does have, which gives them the ability to actually slightly counterattack against me, is this squad of three fire rocket soldiers, the officer of which has line of sight through a hole in the fort wall at the samurai standing quite far away. Obviously, he's not going to get many hits, but actually over the course of the many minutes spent sitting here firing at the enemy, those rockets occasionally coming out of the castle actually did kill one or two of my guys. So the enemy weren't being completely inactive in their defense of the castle, but pretty much they were. Those forces on the east side are just going to sit there because I don't have line of sight on them, and I can't get line of sight. I couldn't get it with my sharpshooters, and my parrot guns would have to move way around the castle to get line of sight, and I'm not going to wait for that, especially because they'd have to go downhill, which would make it harder for them to hit guys in the central area of the castle, which they can just about do at the moment. So now we've moved on much later in the battle, I decided to finally begin my attack. You can see I've got these katana samurai, katana kachi, moving up. The enemy pretty much just fall back from the walls as I advance. Some of them are actually so worried about being killed that they do this nice synchronized dance as they gradually shuffle away from the walls. Looks pretty inconspicuous. If I was their officer, I wouldn't notice them abandoning their post if they're doing it so stylishly. A lot of the guys do just stand around. They weren't on the wall, I guess. I don't really know what they're doing. I think they were actually stuck on the wall to their left, but eventually they notice that my katana samurai are gradually occupying the wall they're supposed to be defending. Elsewhere, I get these line infantry over the wall completely unmolested to go in and capture the tower. I have these guys coming up the wall beside the gatehouse, even though the gate was actually open. I didn't notice that, wasn't looking closely enough. Those garrison infantry have finally decided to actually come and fight with my katana kachi, which of course is a poor decision because those katana kachi have a giant advantage in melee, especially because I think they're quite experienced as well. These are guys coming from Kaga, which has a certain building to give these guys upgrades. I think it may be upgraded armor. So these guys have absolutely no chance against my forces. They simply fall back, the survivors do anyway. I've captured the tower and I've got some guys ready to fire on the enemy as they fall back. Overall, we've pretty much captured the west wing of the castle, so I'm going to proceed to bring all of my main forces inside. Once I was in there, the enemy started charging out of the central area down the ramp from the gate, and I contained them using my Yadikachi and Katanakachi. This enemy force is a mix of their general's heavy cavalry and some spear levy in there amongst the gaps. There's the general himself, you can see, fighting pretty hard against my men. Those heavy cavalry are actually pretty hard to kill, especially for the katana kachi, so they actually were inflicting casualties on me, but gradually I was pushing them back up the ramp. It was happening so slowly though that I decided to simply go around and move forces up the wall on either side of the ramp in order to occupy the central area. The enemy still had a fair few men inside, including those guys who were on the east part of the castle, who've come over to garrison this part of the wall, garrisoning it just as I come over the wall of my own forces. So these guys are now going to fight in melee. My line infantry are much better than their levy garrison infantry in melee, both because line infantry are better by default and because my guys are all level 4, level 5, which massively increases their melee attack and defense. So these levy infantry have no chance fighting in melee. They probably even have less of a chance than they do fighting at range. They pull in some spear levy to fight with my men, but you can see those spear levy are already wavering even as they begin to engage with my line infantry, and I have tons more forces coming over the wall. Overall, it's not looking good for the defenders inside the castle. And here you can see one of the main enemy regiments that was left got outflanked by my carbine infantry, which now blasts them at close range into a completely exposed flank. The enemy take extreme casualties. I tell my carbine infantry to kneel fire, doubling my rate of fire, and you can see the enemy regiment is absolutely demolished by this fire. Super point blank range. I was actually surprised it wasn't demolished even faster. The carbine infantry aren't all that accurate, but they have a really high rate of fire. So you can see after about 10 seconds, that huge blob of enemy troops completely removed from the battlefield. The survivors will not last very long against my men now pushing out of the gatehouse. So the central area of the castle has been captured, but the battle was over before I could capture the Tenchu because we actually slaughtered the enemy down to the very last man. A decisive victory for Takamichi and his forces. This means that the Nagoka have lost their capital, their last stronghold, and all of their last forces. This long-term enemy of the Sioux has finally been defeated after a long war. Perhaps they won't be the last clan to meet that fate. That's all for this week. We'll take on the Satsuma Imperial Vanguard's army and push further east next time on Teppou Republic. Take revenge. The Odawara clan are moving around and they move more forces into Suruga, so it looks like they do plan to attack the castle, although of course they can't possibly take it, so in many ways moving closer is just making it easier for me to counterattack them. Now we have news that an army somewhere has been sabotaged, and that could potentially be very bad, but actually it turns out it's just these guys in Mino. For some reason the enemy decided to sabotage them, but luckily that does absolutely nothing to my plan. I don't care about those guys, so fine, the enemy are just wasting their money on that sabotage, very good news. North Shinano is almost safe, but Kodama is still going to hang around there and defend just in case something happens. The Edo still might invade from the east, and I'm about to secure the north, of course, by trying to take Echigo, which I'm going to sort out now. First, I need to get rid of those Yonezawa forces that I mentioned earlier. They will not stand and fight because obviously they have a massive disadvantage, so that just pushes them out of the picture, leaving my route to the castle completely open. I'll begin sieging it with Takamichi's army. We already have a good advantage. You can see the enemy force crucially has no artillery, especially no mortars, so I can use my artillery advantage to reduce their numbers before I actually go into the assault. Also, the reinforcement group has some upgraded elite skirmishers, some sharpshooters who'll be able to take our enemy units on the wall really easily, further reducing their strength before we attack. So I'm going to use these siege skirmish tactics to try and minimize the amount of enemy resistance, and then I'm going to go into a proper castle assault. I'm going to do that on the battlefield and try and make sure that Takamichi's force remains as intact as possible, giving us the option to move on and attack further enemy provinces right away. The Shogun must be rapidly preparing his headstone now. A hard march would put us at the gates of the Shogunal Palace of Edo in 10 days. Doubtless he will have fled by the time we arrive, destroying the morale of those small-minded folk loyal enough to defend the center of their world. But just think, once the Westerners learn that the capital of their trading partner has fallen to so-called rebels, the speed with which they shall withdraw their support for the Shogun will be a thing of legend. I cannot wait to stand in the Shogunal court and declare the rule of him and his Bakumatsu council over. I've deployed on the highest ground I can find near the castle. I still don't have an ideal line of sight, but it's going to be good enough to start bombarding the defenders inside, giving them volleys from my parrot guns. Already one volley has taken out a whole bunch of their garrison infantry defending the walls. So slowly but surely, I'm going to be able to whittle down these forces, destroying the fort walls and killing men inside. You can see I've got a few attack groups, you can see them on the minimap as well, positioned around the castle. They're just going to stand there and watch for now. I've also got those reinforcements coming in from the north part of the map, and those are the guys who have the sharpshooters among them. So I need those sharpshooters to come up and help me out. Unfortunately, the enemy's forces are all on the south side of the castle mainly, so they're going to have to walk all the way around the map in order to get involved in this battle. Unfortunate, but I've got ages to wait. I've got a 40-minute battle to play out, so I might as well spend at least half an hour just destroying the enemy, using up all my ammunition. Over time, you do get diminishing returns as the enemy units that are highly damaged become increasingly more difficult to damage further, but I'm just going to wait out and see how much damage I can do. One thing the enemy does have, which gives them the ability to actually slightly counterattack against me, is this squad of three fire rocket soldiers, the officer of which has line of sight through a hole in the fort wall at the samurai standing quite far away. Obviously, he's not going to get many hits, but actually, over the course of the many minutes spent sitting here firing at the enemy, those rockets occasionally coming out of the castle actually did kill one or two of my guys. So the enemy weren't being completely inactive in their defense of the castle, but pretty much they were. Those forces on the east side are just going to sit there because I don't have line of sight on them, and I can't get line of sight. I couldn't get it with my sharpshooters, and my parrot guns would have to move way around the castle to get line of sight, and I'm not going to wait for that, especially because they'd have to go downhill, which would make it harder for them to hit guys in the central area of the castle, which they can just about do at the moment. So now we've moved on much later in the battle. I decided to finally begin my attack. You can see I've got these katana samurai, katana kachi, moving up. The enemy pretty much just fall back from the walls as I advance. Some of them are actually so worried about being killed that they do this nice synchronized dance as they gradually shuffle away from the walls. Looks pretty inconspicuous. If I was their officer, I wouldn't notice them abandoning their post if they're doing it so stylishly. A lot of the guys do just stand around. They weren't on the wall. I guess I don't really know what they're doing. I think they were actually stuck on the wall to their left. But eventually they notice that my katana samurai are gradually occupying the wall they're supposed to be defending. Elsewhere, I get these line infantry over the wall completely unmolested to go in and capture the tower. I have these guys coming up the wall beside the gatehouse, even though the gate was actually open. I didn't notice that, wasn't looking closely enough. Those garrison infantry have finally decided to actually come in. His main force has been simply wiped out, taking casualties as it came in, routing without fighting, taking even more casualties as it went out. Only a few of their bravest troops remain. You can see these guys are in a position that means they can't be hit by many of my troops, but a couple of them are managing to just about snipe off some of the enemy's front soldiers, and then they fall back and take a blast of mortar fire just to finish them off. So the main body of the enemy's force is now going off the field. They still have these artillery pieces who have decided to relocate. They're moving up the hill for reasons unknown. Handy for me because they were actually dealing a few casualties to my flank by firing at me, but unfortunately for them, my cavalry are going to come down said hill to counter their advance, and now these light guns are in a lot of trouble. Actually, the cavalry aren't particularly good against light guns. I think light guns have very high melee stats, so you can see they actually don't lose anyone to these cavalry charges, and they even managed to fight on for a good number of seconds before any of my men managed to start killing them. But even once they lose a couple of troops, their army losses will of course such a morale shock that losing a few of their own regiment will cause the entire regiment to break. Those enemy reinforcements are still coming in, though they are not going to break just because the rest of their force has gone, which is a very brave move. These Imperial Loyalists are even getting some shots on my cavalry, so I had to get out of there. I realized that since all of these reinforcement units are just following my cavalry, I can simply move my cavalry back towards my own line, which you can see I'm doing here, so that the enemy's reinforcements will just come over here and have to face my main force, which is still just standing, haven't given them any orders at all. My artillery has finally arrived late to the battle. I might even get a couple of shots off against the enemy's reinforcements. So they pretty much routed after a minute or so once they realized nothing was going well. The replay actually corrupted and caused my computer to crash before it finished the battle. One unit was still left over, but I'm sure you'll believe me that we managed to defeat that final unit. As you can see on the battle results here, absolutely insane performance, under 100 casualties, thousands of enemies lost, and we even captured some of the enemy's light guns. A very good result for the forces of Tamba. The Yonago will not be happy about this crushing defeat. Some more good news is that one of the officers amongst those forces is now eligible to be promoted to a general. I decided I would go ahead with this. It would be very good to have another general here on the western battlefront. So let's see who it is. It's a guy by the name of Kurimitsu. There's nothing particularly special about this guy. He doesn't come with any particular traits or any bonuses. So he's a pure bog standard general, extra loyal, ready to lead our forces. So hopefully he'll do good leading men out of Tamba, which is now a much more viable option now that there's a general nearby. His first mission is going to be to wipe out Yonago's survivors, which of course he can do with ease. No particular worry about these survivors, but it's good to get experience for this young general, trying to get him up to rank 2 by winning a couple of battles. He loses 0 troops in the process. These men of Tamba are going to be pretty used to fighting battles where they lose little to no men. Hopefully I won't be able to break that record for them going forwards. Now I have many options that I can take with him. I can support Takayuki, I can support Takahisa going into Tango, I could even march west and have this guy go on his own campaign, but in the end I decided to just hang around in Tamba and defend it until I knew what I was definitely planning to do about the whole western strategy situation. Now you might remember, I'm currently gambling on whether the Satsuma I'm going to go against Harima or Setsu. Both are okay, I'm ready to defend both, so we'll see what they do as we go through to the next turn. They get rid of their ships, they wander off back west, perhaps to get another force to bring over to invade, and then they march eastwards. It looks like they're going for Setsu, although they didn't march straight towards the castle itself, which was interesting. Now Harima also comes under attack from other forces, so it seems that even if the Satsuma aren't going to attack Harima, other people are. Both the Matsue and then the Hiroshima, more importantly, leading quite a large force into the province once all these boats have got out of the way, rushing straight in and then taking cover in some forest. So it looks like Takayuki's got a bit of clearing up to do, whatever happens. Then the Odawara attack towards Suruga, even though I haven't finished taking it yet, so it seems they plan to go to war with us as well, the first time we've really fought with Odawara forces. So I was wondering, looking at the Satsuma army, was it going for my tea fields, or was it even going for the capital? It's facing in a direction and has moved in such a way that it could be doing either of those. It could still also be going for Setsu. I noticed I could move forces to defend the tea fields to prevent them from raiding them, but I don't want to force a battle in the open if I don't have to. The ideal situation right now is for the enemy to attack Setsu, because Setsu has Osaka Castle, the best castle in the game, which is extremely easy to defend. You might remember the problems I had taking it. So I'd like to try and use that defensive advantage if I can by luring the enemy to attack the castle wall. So I'm going to gamble that that's going to be possible and take a defensive stance for now.
Everyone else is very well and wishes you to know that they pray for your success every day. It seems that as the weeks have gone by, you have moved further and further away from us in both senses. I know the pressures of this war must be hard to bear, and you are going through something I would never wish upon you, but please remember that you are only a man. Once all this is over, you must be able to return to how you were before all this. Return to us and be able to live happily, putting the darkness of this war behind you. Of course, I know nothing of that struggle, but I'll do all I can to help.
The hidden Hiroshima army was revealed during the end turn sequence, so now we can just attack it with Takayuki's force. It runs away, it's quite damaged, it's actually mostly melee units that are not really in a quite fit state to fight, so they get out of there. I can't really pursue them though because of the Matsue forces who could come down and attempt to take Harima or at least damage the infrastructure. So I decided I would just hang around the castle and continue the defensive in this area and see what all these enemy armies actually do. Up in Wakasa, Takahisa has finally reached the battlefront. It's finally time for him to get involved in a campaign moving west into Tango. I'm going to link him up with some extra forces from the castle at Wakasa, who've been there for absolutely ages now, defending this area against a possible Yonago attack, which actually never came in the end. So these guys are finally going to get some action, joining up with Takahisa's group as reinforcements, just going to follow him in. I'm also going to link up, as reinforcements, the new army of our new general Tsuchiya Kunimitsu, who is going to abandon Tamba for the time being and come and help Takahisa take Tango province. I am gambling slightly that nothing will happen in Tamba and there'll be no enemy invasions to worry about, but I think, given what I know about the enemy's strength in the area, that's an okay gamble. Back over in Suruga, all of our movement points are recharged. It's time to fully attack Suruga Castle by bringing in reinforcements and, of course, Anagukoji Yoshiyuji's artillery, meaning that now, when I try and engage the castle in a siege assault, the balance bar is super in my favor, so I'm going to take my victory via auto-resolve. This, of course, is the final stronghold of the Sunpu clan, so that's the end for them. Just over 200 losses, over 1,000 enemies killed, and wooden cannons captured, whoop-de-doo. So yes, that's the end of the Sunpu. A long-term enemy has finally been defeated, hopefully the first of many long-term enemies to topple in the near future. This province also has the potential to build a railway station, so I can connect it back to Owari and get it easily reinforceable, just like I could with Harima province. The Odawara are moving into the province already, as we saw earlier, so I might have to defend it very soon, so I'm just going to cluster around the castle ready for that. But nearby in Kai, Tananao's forces are going to move out without waiting for reinforcements to start moving towards Musashi province, the seat of the Shogun and one of the key victory provinces on the map. I decided that if I could catch it unawares and simply capture it and hold it for a while, this would be a key gain in terms of territory, morale, and it would mean the Odawara clan are potentially going to be outflanked if Tanenao was to then move back west and attack provinces like Sagami. Meanwhile, up in North Shinano, you can see Kodama's going on the offensive against this small Nagoka group. I don't know what they're doing, perhaps they had the same motivation as the Daimyo that came down earlier. They've brought a set of units which I've never seen before, Prussian advisors, a bunch of Westerners it seems. I don't know what they thought they were doing or what their plan could have possibly been, but whatever it was, it's been thwarted by the sheer military strength of Kodama and his men. So North Shinano remains safe. And of course the situation for the Nagoka is now getting really bad. We can see to the north that Echigo, their final province, isn't looking particularly strong. They only have a few forces left with the defeat of their daimyo and those advisors, and Takamichi is going to take advantage of this. The plan for him is to move right on their capital and attempt to take it. I'm using the shinobi to make sure there's no surprises coming up from behind their capital that might stop me from doing that, It looks pretty clear, so it's probably going to be safe for me to take the two turns I'm going to need to march over to Echigo from the border at Echu. I am also going to have to defeat those Yonezawa forces who are hanging around, but of course that should be no challenge. You can see there are also some hostile navies. These are actually Imperial navies that are currently attacking the Nagoka, which partially explains why they're so weak. So they might bombard me, but overall, not too worried about that. We should be fine. Echigo is almost as good as in our hands. Now moving into the next turn, that Satsuma landing force moves and goes past Setsu. It doesn't look like it's going to attack the castle. Interesting. The Suano clan move a small group past Takahisa and his forces into the forest. The Matsue bypass Harima and appear to go towards Setsu. Also very interesting. And that Hiroshima army that ran away from us earlier moves back and attacks the telegraph office north of Harima, preventing me from building the railway station that I was trying to do. Very inconvenient indeed. Perhaps I could be advantaged because my artillery will have to come in as reinforcements. But once I'm all set up, I'm pretty confident I can destroy this Yonago force as long as it doesn't get too close. Let's see what I can do about it. Now, we've seen this battlefield before, fighting the Yonago actually, in a pretty similar situation. I'm going to use the same strategy I did then. I deployed mostly on a ridge on a slight hill on my right flank, with an extended line going off onto the plains on the south side of the map. Pretty much just a big long line infantry line with a few blocks of melee infantry behind, ready to move out if needs be. The reinforcements coming in are two regiments of cavalry, very useful, and loads of artillery. That artillery is going to be slow moving, and I'm ordering it to go and sit on the ridge behind my troops where it would be able to fire over them, but actually it's not even going to get there before the enemy arrive. They're already pretty close, they're running right at us. My mortars are set up already, so I do have a little bit of artillery to put some pressure on them, but mainly they're going to advance unmolested. They've got lots of thick lines of melee troops, just a few missile troops in the vanguard, and a couple of missile troops at the back as well. Not a particularly good use of their missile troops, really. They do have this artillery already set up, which is currently firing at the extreme left of my army. You can see these formations are a little bit disrupted. It's these domain guards, which you might remember last time when we fought the Yonago here, the enemy artillery focused on the domain guards as well. So those domain guards really must have done something in past lives to be attacked so much by artillery. So the enemy's advance is going to be slightly hampered by my mortars, but for the most part, they're actually going to be fine. The enemy, of course, does have reinforcements coming in as well. You can see them here, a few units coming over the hill on the north side of the map. But since the enemy are just charging right in, those reinforcements will not link up with their main force before the attack begins. Now you can see the enemy on both of their flanks are sending out cavalry. On my right flank, I have my own cavalry, who I can set up in a position to counter their cavalry, stopping them from getting behind me. On the other side, I don't really have a good way to stop their cavalry. However, because they've advanced in front of the main force, they're now receiving the focus of my gunners, who are firing at them pretty rapidly. You can see all of the enemy's artillery is landing way short of my line. They're very inaccurate, those enemy 6-inch guns. The enemy cavalry get really close. They almost get a nice charge on my line, and a point-blank volley from two lines completely obliterates their unit. A couple of men get caught up by my spearmen, the survivors sensibly run away. Meanwhile, on my right flank, I've used one unit of cavalry to lock the enemy's cav down. The other unit is set on some waypoint orders to take this small bit of high ground and then turn and charge into the melee in order to finish off the enemy cavalry. My one unit was actually winning because of its superior experience, but now we're going to completely seal the deal by charging down the hill, smashing into the enemy's cavalry ranks, and that causes the enemy's cavalry unit to rout. So on both sides, the enemy's cavalry advance has been thwarted. Like those fleeting images of a dream fighting for your attention as you awake, these Imperial thralls bellow and shout like a train of fools. They will give their lives out of sheer envy for the glory, the pride, the national renown of us, the heroes who history shall say changed the world for the better. Think nothing of those lowly worms cawing for recognition, bashing their outdated texts and dying for their outdated traditions. Take faith in the future that your rifles will bring. Take aim at the men who refuse to cast off their darkness, and take the lives of those who oppose the revolution. So now the main part of the fight has started in the center. The enemy with all of their melee units are simply charging us. That's pretty much all they can do. The rolling hills gives them some cover, meaning a lot of them get really close to our line, as you can see here. But now coming up the final hill towards the position of our men, these troops are being gunned down and their morale is suffering. They're falling back as they get close. A few men who do get really close are countered by my own Yadikachi, who push them right back. The enemy forces are put into disarray, essentially, as I come around onto their flank with this echelon to put even more fire on them, which causes some of the full strength units to start falling back. This force doesn't have a general, so a lot of their lesser men are falling back even without putting up much of a fight. These reservists, for example, aren't going to fight for long. They take a few casualties and get out of there. Some of the more professional units, like these attendants and the rifle attendants hanging around here, will fight on, but of course the loss of all their allies means they're pretty much doomed. Meanwhile, my cavalry has been flirting with the enemy's reinforcements. Here you can see I'm charging a unit of Bokachi, who managed to get a nice volley on me, but it barely did any casualties whatsoever. And now I'm going to completely reverse that situation by dealing extreme casualties to these Bokachi. You can see on the tooltip their numbers have dropped extremely quickly. Their unit is wiped out in just a few seconds. The problem is that the enemy reinforcements are now advancing up this hill towards my cavalry, but I still have an avenue of escape, so I'm going to get out of there and leave the enemy reinforcements to just be chasing me, not taking part in the main fight. That main fight is now pretty much over. Look at this hillside, completely covered in enemy bodies. Hello and welcome to another episode of Teppou Republic. On the last episode, we saw Takamichi going up against the Sado army that was marching on Hida province, catching it up and engaging it in battle. We set up a nice formation on a hill and outgunned the enemy, plus made good use of our own cavalry to stop the enemy's cavalry from hitting our lines, in the end defeating them quite soundly. Then Angakoji Yoshiyuji was on the offensive in Suruga province, attacking one of the Sumpu armies after we found out that the Sumpu don't have many forces left and we decided to put more pressure on them. Then we saw a Satsuma Imperial Vanguard army land itself near Harima in Takayuki's position. We'll have to see what that does. Then the Sunpu counterattacks Yoshiyuji's forces. He managed to back up the small group that was under attack to force a fair battle. It was a nice dingy day where both sides' artillery were not being put to very good use because of the forested conditions, but we ended up defeating them by sheer skill and the zeal of our troops overcoming the enemy. Then Tanenao attacked the province of Kai, one of the Sunpu's strongholds, leaving them without any troops and with only one castle left, and Nagakoji Yoshiyuji should be able to finish them off. Let's continue. The local people have been less cooperative than expected. We're already short on food. We should have brought a proper baggage train.
No, you're wrong. The baggage train forces us to move slowly. Without it, we shall be so swift that the Emperor will see our faces almost as soon as he has heard of our approach. Besides, the capital surely cannot have fallen in line with the Su lies. There we shall have all the supplies we need. This current shortage serves only to inspire our men to reach our destination even sooner.
You assume it will even be possible to get that far on our current supply. The truth is, if we don't raid the villages, then we'll...
No! Raiding the villages is exactly what the Sioux would want us to do. We are here as champions of the people and the Emperor.
Then what if we run out? Are we to attack Osaka Castle? I have heard the Sioux have a garrison there large enough to hold it for years.
And since the Sioux are using railways, there could be a Sioux army at the capital by the time we reach it. My men can't fight without food.
These paranoid speculations are doing us no good. We attack the capital, we do not stop before we get there, and we do not let fear of battle take a single breath from us. Understood?
Yes, my lord.
Welcome back. You can see that Tanenao has indeed just captured Kai, but he has some reinforcements who he left behind in the last episode because the opportunity to take Kai was so good I couldn't wait for them to arrive. Those reinforcements will now start making their way to join up with Tanenao, and eventually will have a formidable force that can attack east towards more shogunate lands. You can also see we've captured some copper reserves, good news. and Kokoji Yoshiuji is still besieging Suruga, so for now I'm going to let that situation continue. Takamichi, who defeated the Seido forces here in Echu, is now going to move up towards Echigo. I know the Nagoka are up there, but I'm going to use the shinobi I have standing around to find out exactly what the situation is. You can see the Yonago are besieging the port in this area. It seems the Imperials are still going at it with the Shogunals, despite also having to face me. The Nagoka have almost nothing here, it's just a few Yonezawa forces who are standing around the castle for unknown reasons, but overall looks pretty weak, so Takamichi should be able to push into that area soon. Now I also realized that I can pull up more forces to join Yoshiyuji with the siege on Suruga. I can also pull up this shinobi who currently is hanging around to Toyami but isn't going to be needed there. Once I capture Suruga, I can slot him into the town to expand my line of sight or have him march with Yoshiyuji, so I'm going to move him up. Now, way over in the west side of our domain, the Yonago are currently besieging Tamba, and I decided it's about time we stop them from doing this. I noticed that their army is very melee heavy, whereas ours is very missile heavy, which in general gives us an advantage. Their melee heavy army will only have an advantage if the terrain and the weather are both in their favor. So, assuming that's probably not going to be the case, I felt pretty safe just attempting to beat off this army with a siege sally. You can see the balance bar is about even, but I do think I have an advantage. The enemy had an initial artillery.